want to suggest today, and I hopefully want to model today, that another way to mark time in terms of when we take seriously and take stock of major historical moments is not by merely offering political responses, by also offering meditative, thoughtful, and study responses. And so this moment of the Jewish people marking 2017, a series of massive historical anniversaries about the State of Israel, it may be both an opportunity for organizing, and it may also be an opportunity for deep thinking. And I hope for a little bit, at least, of the latter. In the title of today, I buried the lead a little bit of the major anniversary that most people are assuming that we are commemorating this year, which is the 50th anniversary of the Six-Day War. However, it just happens to be, and it's kind of weird and strange, that actually 2017 is the marker of at least four significant anniversaries in the State of Israel and in the history of Zionism. The first is that 2017 marks 120 years to the first Zionist Congress that took place in Basel in 1897. 2017 marks the 100th year anniversary of the Balfour Declaration. 2017 marks the 70th anniversary of the Partition Plan, and then the 50th anniversary of the Six-Day War, the 1967 war. You can actually keep going a little further if you want. 1977, the Begin Revolution, but it starts to peter out a little bit after 1967. And while most of the remarks that I want to offer today hinge on what it means for the Jewish people in the State of Israel to mark 50 years since the Six-Day War, and the two directions in which political activism is being galvanized in the Jewish community in response to this anniversary, I do want to take a moment to acknowledge that those anniversaries are not just no less significant when it comes to marking Israel and its history, but that actually each of them has their own kind of interpretive legacy that, would we have more time, we could really unpack and play out. Marking 120 years since the first Zionist Congress in 1897 is a means of acknowledging a really significant change for the Jewish people in our own orientation towards our history. 1897 is not the first time in Jewish history in which Jews think differently about the role of God in history and take on their own possibility of their own political legacies, but it certainly is significant as a moment in time that that announces the Jewish people's taking seriously their own political destiny into their hands. And that is its own curriculum to think about, the difference between a diasporic sensibility in which you wait for the hand of God to simply transform the condition that you're in versus convening towards your own political future in the hope of being able to transform a reality that you haven't liked into one that you might control. 1917 marks for the Jewish people a massive moment in the Jewish people's belonging to, participating in, and willingness to be subject to the rules of the family of nations. The reason why the Balfour Declaration, among many, is so significant for the Jewish people in the State of Israel is precisely because it's not the Rosenberg Declaration. The significance of actually marking that the one of the catalyst moments to Zionism and the return to Jewish sovereignty is being recognized by the family of nations and the international community that your own dignity and self-worth, as marked by your sovereignty, can be awarded to you and you can belong to the family of nations represents a significant shift for the Jewish people in our own self-understanding as seeing ourselves not as an outlier to the family of nations, but as a genuine and bona fide participant. 1947, marking the Partition Plan, invites us to study and to think about the appearance for the Jewish people, the awareness that our national story exists simultaneously with the national story of another people that shares this land. So when we talk about a Partition Plan, we, as Jews, who appreciate the rise of the State of Israel, tend to focus on the piece of the Partition Plan that made possible our own sovereignty. But in celebrating a Partition Plan, what you are essentially celebrating is that your sovereignty and the sovereignty of another people are in some ways contingent and conditional upon one another. And of course, we get to 1967. I'm naming all of these because I think if you're going to do the work of pausing at a historical moment to acknowledge the significance of the anniversary, it's actually worth playing out all of the significances of the different anniversaries rather than simply imagining that we stop history at one particular and arbitrary piece of time. I'm also mentioning all of these as a means of a plug. This topic, 1917, 1947, 1967, will be the content for our study retreats in Israel this summer for lay people and for rabbis, and we will have more than an hour and 15 minutes to unpack all of the political significance of these moments, and I hope that you can join us. But obviously, the critical anniversary and the one that is animating the most tension and anxiety in the Jewish community is marking 50 years since the Six-Day War, 50 years since the 1967 war, or in certain parlance, 50 years since the reunification of Jerusalem, or in other parlance, and oftentimes these two things don't travel together, 50 years of occupation. And by listing out all of those different terms, what I'm trying to do, even though I have my own strong political biases, is to name that the use of this historical time to mark particular anniversaries has largely been occupied, for lack of a better word, by those who are seeking to leverage these historical moments to translate into very concrete interpretive outcomes about the meaning of history, and then political outcomes about what one is supposed to do in response to that history. And what we have a challenge to do, those of us who are concerned not just by Israel's moral actions and moral character, but also by the equally compelling and urgent issue of whether we as a Jewish community can still see ourselves as members of a shared Jewish community in spite of our political differences, we are challenged to try to think about the issue of these anniversaries, knowing that they are being wrenched in particular directions on right and left to mark these events, and to try to see whether we can comprise some sort of larger community capable of wrestling with the legacy of our past as a vehicle towards the improvement towards our future. Needless to say, both of the right-wing and left-wing interpretations of marking this history imagine that when you hit the 50th year point, something happens, something changes. I want to leave as a footnote the question of whether marking time is in some ways totally arbitrary to begin with, and therefore doesn't necessarily need or require of us that since I hit a certain point, I therefore need to start doing something really different. I'm naming that because I'm not even sure I believe it, because we do mark our own significant milestone birthdays as being bigger deals than the other ones. Right? Those 10-year blocks are more significant than the random assortment of prime number birthdays that happened in between. Right? So we know that psychologically when we hit certain milestones, something changes. That's when we hit our various crises in life. When we hit those birthdays, some taking stock or taking seriously, what have I done until this point and what might I do differently, is a common, deeply human instinct in terms of the marking of time. So it's reasonable that the Jewish people are looking at this 50th year of since the Six-Day War and saying, what has it meant until now, and what might we do differently as a result, and that there's a little nugget there of maybe it's all a little bit arbitrary. But both of the conclusions that are drawn by the right and the left tend to assume that once I hit the 50-year mark, I am either on a path for which there is no return. If I don't do something now, the conditions that we have created will become permanent. Or, once I hit this point, I have to enter in an anxiety that if I don't start a kind of political activism now, I will be in some ways complicit to realities that I have been able to control. And that's why it's not a coincidence that the rise towards the movement of annexation of parts of the West Bank is taking place now in 2017. It's not a coincidence that right-wing politicians are leveraging this moment to say, okay, we hit 50 years, that means this is probably not merely an interim or temporary occupation, which is a language that the State of Israel has used itself to describe what's actually taking place in the West Bank until now. So it is a political term, and it's also a descriptive term. So that's not a surprise to see this move from right-wing politicians to say, now's the time to kind of seal the deal around the success of the conquest of these lands 50 years ago. Now's the time to do that. And similarly, it's not a surprise to see certain synagogues, congregations who lean right in the American Jewish community using this moment to seal the deal about this marking 50 years of the reunification of Jerusalem. So there is a spike in synagogue trips that are scheduled for this May, coinciding with the anniversary of the reunification of Jerusalem, to mark the hybrid religious political sensibility that the reunification of Jerusalem has brought about something significant and transformative for the Jewish people in the state of Israel, that now we should be marking and sealing as a permanent condition. It's also not surprising, and this is the equivalent version of the same story on the left, that the moment of recognition that this is 50 years of occupation invites those on the left to use this moment to respond the way that they are responding with a new wave of activism to require of Jewish communal leaders, in some cases, to proclaim their opposition to the occupation, or to create radical change on the ground in terms of policy, that once you hit this certain threshold, milestone number, if we don't activate our sensibilities now, when will be, right? When will that actually happen? And so the marking of time is inviting a set of activities on both right and left that imagine that simply because I hit a milestone anniversary when it comes to these historical moments, I am required, therefore, in this moment, I'm on a path of no return. And my job is either to cement that path of no return or to prevent in the final throes of its taking place whether that's actually going to happen. The first question I want to ask is whether this is the inevitable way in which we as Jews think about the marking of meaningful time. I know that we're inclined, I think, as humans to do that, and I want to ask whether that's the case, and I want to actually present before you two different options sourced from Jewish thought, in which, in one case, when I reach the marking of time, I feel a sense of profound urgency to do something different than I've done before, to correct the historical problems and the historical flaws of my past. And the other text that I want to look at is an incredibly humilifying text about the passage of time, which reminds us that it's in historical milestones and historical moments that we realize that any change we can bring about in the world can be almost by definition incremental. That we must be terrified by the instinct, very natural, to think that our job is to mark historical moments through radical change. I want to see whether we can hold those together and allow those to maybe be the brackets of a conversation in a community that, left unchecked, has the risk of becoming incredibly unstable and really polarizing. The first text I want to look at, and if you have, hopefully everyone has sources, there should be more lying around. If people don't have, there's some in the back. The first text I want to look at is the text from Leviticus 25, which is in some ways the most perfect and on-the-nose Jewish text to use to think about this moment, although the more on-the-nose it is, the more contentious it is politically to actually deploy it here. Oftentimes in my own teaching, you know, I try to find like a text that helps us think about an issue, but ideally the text itself has no relationship to that issue. So you kind of have to do the work to move the text. And lo and behold, though, we have, for better or worse, a text in our own tradition that tells us what happens when you hit the 50th year of land ownership in the land of Israel. What are you supposed to do? And this is the marking of the Jubilee year. And there are ways in which this text is actually really helpful to us to think about the 1967-2017 anniversary, but not always in the ways that you might think. So let's look at it a little bit together. I'm going to read the first section quickly because it'll help us. The Lord spoke to Moses on Mount Sinai, saying, "Speak to the Israelite people and say to them, when you enter the land which I give you, the land shall observe a Sabbath of the Lord. 6 years you shall sow your field, 6 years you shall prune your vineyard, and gather in the produce thereof. But in 7th year the land shall have a Sabbath of complete rest, a Sabbath of the Lord. You shall not sow your field or prune your vineyard. You shall not reap the aftergrowth of your harvest, gather the grapes of your untrimmed vines. It shall be a year of complete rest for the land. But you may eat whatever of the land that it'll produce you during its Sabbath, your male and female slaves, your hired and bound laborers who live with you, and your cattle and the beasts in your land may eat all of its yield. This is what is known as the sabbatical year, the Shemitah, the very easy metaphor from 7 days of creation, and on the seventh you shall rest. So too the land works for 6 years, and on the seventh the land rests. And it's worth noting that the sabbatical year is meant for the land and not really for the people. Right? You don't really actually stop working. You stop working the land and you benefit from its produce. But the Shemitah year, the sabbatical year, is meant for the land itself. And then the Bible goes on to say, you're going to wind up counting 7 of these sabbatical years and you're going to hit what we call the mega sabbatical, which is the Jubilee. You shall count off 7 weeks of years, 7 times 7 years, so that the period of 7 weeks of years gives you a total of 49 years. Thank you, Bible. Then you shall sound the horn loud. Right? So now the history has actually done the work for you, which is the years of the time itself. But now is the first time where I actually do my own action, which is the sounding of the shofar of the Yovel, the shofar of the Jubilee. You sound the horn loud. In the 7th month, on the 10th day of the month, the Day of Atonement, you shall have the horn sounded throughout your land, and you shall hallow the 50th year. You shall, it's worth noticing, and we can study this more, who's doing the hallowing, right? When it comes to Shabbat, God is the one who hallows, makes holy the 7th day, but actually it's you making holy the 50th year. There's a tremendous amount of human agency that's imagined for the Jubilee year here. You shall proclaim release throughout the land for all of its inhabitants. This shall be a Jubilee year for you. Each of you shall return to his holding, and each of you shall return to his family. Now, the goal of the Jubilee year is not merely a vacation. Right? It's not just we mark these sabbatical years and therefore people get to take a rest for the year. The Jubilee year is trying to solve for a different problem. The Jubilee year is trying to solve for the problem of the inheritance of poverty. And the theory of the Bible is fundamentally that the land all essentially belongs to God. The land of Israel, remember, has a special relationship with the Jewish people in ways that lands don't usually have relationships with people. We know this from elsewhere in the book of Leviticus, that when you live on the land of Israel as the Jewish people and you misbehave on that land, the land has anthropomorphic qualities such as the ability to spit you out of that land for you are undeserving, which has really interesting ramifications for teen tours. Right? The land actually can do things to you based on your misdeeds. And so there's a special quality, special relationship between the Israelites and God in which the land of Israel functions as the Jewish people's barometer. When you behave, we know this from the second paragraph of Shema, when you behave, you get the weather that you need and you get the crops. When you don't behave, God first withholds that rain and you do not get what you need. And if you continue to not behave, you will ultimately lose the access to and the privilege to that land. And therefore, if the land is actually meant as a vehicle or a barometer to relationship with God, how can it be possible over time that certain people wind up extremely wealthy and certain people wind up impoverished? In other words, God's land can't possibly be the land that's associated with the debilitation of the social order if, in fact, a healthy social order is part of what's imagined for the Jewish people as being the tools of building their own type of moral society. That's not possible. And therefore, humans are empowered when they hit the 50th year to make sure that poverty not be more than 2 generations. And after 50 years, you're supposed to relinquish the fact that somebody ran into trouble. And because that person ran into trouble, I don't know, mismanaged their crops, had a gambling problem, whatever it is, wound up having to sell over their land and become a sharecropper on their land, or worse, went into a terrible version of debt slavery, and you've managed to create a massive misallocation of the land resources that no longer correlate to the way that the land was divided equitably and fairly to all of the Israelites and their families during the Exodus from Egypt. And as a result, once I hit this 50th year, I have to do a massive reallocation of land back to their ancestral holdings and let everybody have a fresh start. It's a profound vision of social justice for the Jewish people, which requires this tremendous leap of faith that once I reach a certain point, I know if I leave certain behaviors unchecked, those behaviors will simply metastasize. And any vision that I have for a socially just society will wind up giving way to simply the natural process of the passage of time. The text goes on to say that 50th year shall be a jubilee year for you. And notice, remember when we talked about the sabbatical, it's a sabbatical for the land, but jubilee is for you. It's not about the land anymore. It's about you, the people, you, the social order. I don't care really about the land needing to rest. What I'm nervous about is what land ownership does to people. And you can become damaged by your obsession or fixation with further acquisition of land. You can read as many political intonations into that as you want. You can become so fixated with the acquisition of land that something will become damaged in your capacity, your ability to live out the vision of social justice for your society that you want. So now the jubilee year is for you as opposed to being the land. And again, you shall not sow, neither shall you reap the aftergrowth. In verse 13, in this year of jubilee, each of you shall return to his holding. Now, the Bible becomes aware of a problem. If I know that at year 50, everything is going to revert back to its original holder, what I might do is stop transacting in commerce with people starting from a few years before. Because I don't want to create a situation where somebody, if I'm a lender, and somebody borrows money from me, or the land ownership changes, but that guy knows he can get it back in 2 years, it's kind of a raw deal for me to do that. And to the extent that debt is actually initially meant as a tool of social justice, the withholding of debt can also become an instrument that damages the prospect of social justice. Debt at its core is a vehicle by which some people help other people to have the capital to improve their condition. But if those debts are going to be loosened, then why would I want to take the risk of lending to somebody else? So the Bible knows this concern and says when you sell property to your neighbor, you shouldn't wrong one another. In buying from your neighbor, you should deduct only for the number of years since the Jubilee and so on and so forth. Verse 17, do not wrong one another, but fear your God, for I am the Lord your God. You shall observe my laws and faithfully keep my rules. That you may live upon the land in security. The land shall yield its fruit, and you shall eat your fill, and you shall live upon it in security. 23, but the land must not be sold beyond reclaim, for the land is mine. You are but strangers resident with me. Throughout the land that you hold, you must provide for the redemption of this land. I want to make two last points here about this text, because I think they're critical. Before I get to verse 13, I might conclude that what has to happen is a massive program of correcting the injustices of the societies that we have the minute that we hit year 50. So if, for instance, you are a biblical fundamentalist, you might take a text like this and say, 50 years of occupation, time to just give it back. That's only if you're a biblical fundamentalist, by the way, who takes the word of the Bible literally and lives your life by it. But I might look at that and say, I'm supposed to now do something dramatic when I hit this moment. And I hear that momentum kind of building up in the text, that the text is telling me you are not allowed to pass a certain threshold in time. Once you hit a massive anniversary, you can never allow for an injustice to be perpetrated long past that. You have to wake up the morning of Yom Kippur on the Jubilee year, blow that shofar, and change your ways. And that is resonant with us of what I said at the outset of, I hit 50 years, now I need to stop doing what I'm doing and start doing something different. But the second half of this Leviticus text is equally important, and it's so tempting to get lost. Why do I keep now talking about God, and why do I keep talking about security? The code, I think, the key to this whole text is that the only way that people take risks to advance a cause of social justice in their own societies is if there is a guarantor. What is the guarantor that makes possible for the Israelites to actually do what is imagined here in the Jubilee year, but God? And God is a guarantor in two ways. Number one, God says, I will provide for you. I know you're scared. I know relinquishing that land that you've acquired over time, which you see as the instrument for your financial security, may make you feel vulnerable. But I will reward your willingness to inhabit a place of vulnerability by providing for you the security that you want. And secondly, God says, it's not just about what I'm providing for you, but I'm also going to remind you that you are fundamentally tenants. This is actually mine. So the more that you actually persist in holding on to this land long past the time where it's supposed to be yours, you are actually not stealing from your fellow people, you're stealing from me. So I get both the carrot and the stick at the same time. God warning you about essentially an implied punishment here of what's going to happen to you if you actually rebel against me. This is why it's not about the land, it's about you. And at the same time, God promising the reward of I will take care of you. And when I look at a text like this and think about its implications, its ramifications for the present, I on one hand feel pulled by the sense of urgency that the first half of the text tells me. I hit 50 years, now what are the radical shifts, what are the radical changes that I'm supposed to make in my society? What is the land, how do I give back all this land? And I'm also feeling pulled in the second half of the text by the only times when people are willing to actually make sacrifices that come at the risk of what they consider to be their holdings is when they feel that sense of security. So if we're going to have a conversation, number one, this is text number one, and we'll look at one other, I guess. If we're going to have a real conversation about how do we mark time, how do we confront an anniversary, can we listen both in one side of our head to this first half of the text, which invites us or challenges us to notice that the passage of time invites a sense of profound urgency, and at the same time, listen with our other ear to the second half of the text, which says that the only times when people can actually take risks that actually entail the restructuring of the social order is if they believe that those risks will be rewarded by a sense of certainty or a sense of security. What I'm enchanted by, especially in the second half of this text, is that you can hear the anxiety of the people in God's voice. If God has to keep saying over and over again, "Don't worry, I'll take care of you," I know exactly why, even though this is like straight biblical law. Bible doesn't always tell us, do this and don't worry, I'll take care of you. But it's precisely when the demand that the Bible is making of what we're supposed to do actually runs counter to what we might think to be our long-term self-interest, that God, in God's mercy, actually, is naming, I will take care of you in order to enable you to take that risks. So one question I want us to think about and come back to is, mapping this text onto a contemporary conversation, what is the urgency of what needs to change, and what is the sense of security that makes possible people to take risks towards this end? But if I've set up here so far that the marking of time pushes us in one direction towards a sense of urgency and one sense towards a sense of insecurity, I want to play that out a little bit more. The sense of urgency text, I'm not going to read it entirely here. You can take it for your homework. It's good shul reading. I say that a lot. It's good shul reading. This famous piece from Kafka's Before the Law, from the Trial, a classic, dare I say, Kafka-esque text about what happens to a human being after after his entire life is lived and realizes that he fails to walk through the very door that's created for him. And this I just wanted to put out there as one of the kind of psychological instruments by which we as people who mark historical moments, sometimes we fear, sometimes the psychology of why it is we feel that we reach a certain point in time and things now have to change dramatically is because just that very ephemeral and human fear that we're running out of that time. If I don't do it now, when will it be? There's been a series of op-eds by Jewish leaders in the last few years who have indicated in one form or another, I'm reaching the end of my career and I've decided to give up on Israel. I'm not going to name names, but you can Google it. And what that reflects to me is a little bit of the mortal self-awareness that problems that I thought were going to be solved in my lifetime are not going to be solved. And since I can't fix them, I would rather avoid the cognitive dissonance of being in relationship to a broken story and rather simply feel pristine by disconnecting myself to that from that broken story. And what that imagines psychologically is that when I hit a certain point in my life, I want things to get cleaned up. And if not, it will almost retroactively mean that all of that time of longing towards the time when it's going to get fixed was somehow not worth it. That's a big piece of the human spirit is caught up in that, of the belief that I hit a time, now it had better get done because we're running out of that time. But there's another voice from within Jewish tradition that I want to name, which looks at the passage of time and tells people, when you hit the massive passage of time, that's not the time when you become aware of what you did or didn't do. It's recognizing that all change takes place in the world slowly and incrementally. And that instinct, if we don't stop the occupation today, it will never stop, actually not only is untrue to the human experience of way revolutions actually take place, but it actually undermines the possibility of doing the work incrementally that might get you towards where you want to go, even if you then have to live with the possibility of not seeing the change that you want to get in your own lifetime. And to do this, I want to read this story from the Babylonian Talmud Tani 23a, really one of the most tragic rabbinic stories. And we're going to read past the point by which it's usually used for the material that is put on a plaque for a shul dinner. You'll recognize it. Rabbi Yochanan said, all his life, that righteous person, that is talking about a character named Choni the circle drawer, who in other aspects of rabbinic literature did things like drawing circles around himself and refusing to move until it rained. So he had like this weird holy man quality in the rabbinic tradition. That guy, Choni, was troubled by the verse, when the Lord restored the restoration of Zion, we were like dreamers. And he asked, how can 70 years compare to a dream that lasts one night? Now, what's happening here, it's a learned exegesis buried in this text, that the Psalms imagines that the Israelites waits, the return to Zion that takes place after the destruction of the temple takes place 70 years later. And when they're talking about this, when they're saying, when the Lord actually made that restoration happen, we had been like dreamers, meaning that it felt like it was a very short period of time. And Choni's saying, 70 years is actually a really long period of time. 50 years is a really long period of time. How could an injustice go on for 50 years? That seems interminable. How could 70 years of waiting for the restoration of Zion feel to the psalmist like it was a dream from which he had just woken up? And to explicate this, they tell a couple of stories about Choni. One day he was walking along his way when he saw a certain man planting carob trees. It's one of the great little things of rabbinic literature. Jeffrey Rubenstein's here, so maybe he should teach a class on this, on the phrase Hahu Gavra, the certain man. The rabbis talk about the certain man all the time. Is it the same man? Is it a different man? We don't really know. Is it an imagined literary character like Eliyahu Hanavi, who's always there to kind of solve problems when we need them, like the Waldo, right? The rabbis want us to know that there's something suggestive about this certain man because he's going to teach us something, but they don't actually want us to get distracted in who the man actually is. He saw a man planting carob trees. He said to him, a carob tree does not bear fruit for 70 years. Are you so sure that you will live 70 years and will eat from it? Why are you wasting your time on carob? You know, plant something like, I don't know, etrogs. You know you're going to get a return on that much faster. He said to him, I found the world with carob trees, just as my ancestors planted for me, so I plant for my descendants. End of unit as applies to synagogue plaques. How many people in the room have or have seen this plaque on a synagogue or a tote bag? Okay, you got a bunch. Right? It's a beautiful story. Our job as educators or institution builders is to create the conditions for success to be experienced by others, But it's not actually to think that the seeds that we plant in our own lifetime are actually supposed to bear fruit in our lifetime, which gives you a sense of the radical difference of where we are from the sentiment that's invited by the Jubilee. I'm not supposed to think that I'm going to be able to create a radical reset even after 50 years. The Jubilee had invited this idea that I hit 50 years and now I have to, in a panic, change everything. And by the end of the Jubilee year, I've restored land to its ownership. And by the time I get to these rabbinic traditions, they say, that's not how change works. You plant a seed and you don't expect the possibility of change to come until after you're already dead. For the rabbi, 70 years is a life expectancy. He sat down to eat his bread. Sleep came upon him. While he slept, a grotto surrounded him and concealed him from sight. So we have all sorts of elements of both the Platonic cave that are being imagined here, that's being created around him, as well as any time that human beings wind up going into concealed places, it is a retreat to a womb-like story and possibly a recreation story. So he is now going to wake up again as a different human being. But as we're going to see, he wakes up as a different human being back in his same reality. This is the rabbi. This is going to become, it moves from being a great plaque story to one of the worst tragedies of rabbinic Judaism, which is the imagined fantasy of what if you woke up into a world in which you no longer fit. What would happen if you actually lived longer than you were supposed to and saw the world with the carob trees that you were supposed to just believe in? What would happen to you psychologically? So he slept for 70 years. When he awoke, he saw a man gathering carobs from that carob tree and eating them. Wow, it's perfect. Same guy, perhaps, a relative. He said to them, "Do you know who planted this carob tree?" He said to him, "My father's father." And he said, then 70 years were like a dream. So it's like a cute way of closing up the original part of the story. I slept for 70 years, so actually 70 years can be like a dream. But that's not going to be what the main thrust of the text is about. He went to his home. He said to them, that is the people in his home, "Does the son of Choni the circle drawer yet live?" In other words, my son. Is my son still here? They said to him, "He is no more, but his grandson lives." He said to them, "I am he. I am Choni." Introduces himself to his grandson, who was his carob, right? Or his great-grandson, who didn't know that he would, only had to trust in the possibility that he would exist, but never actually met them. They did not believe him. Why would they believe him, right? Why would they believe that he could possibly be there? He went to the study house. So once he gets closed out from his own house, he goes to the study house. He heard the sages say, "Our traditions are as clear today as in the years of Choni the circle drawer," himself. Like, this is what he's overhearing in the Beit Midrash, where the rabbis are self-congratulating themselves on being as good at understanding the tradition as it was when, in the good old days, when Choni was around. "For when he used to enter the study house," this is the parentheses, "he solved every difficulty that the sages had." He was really good at Judaism, right? So when he was around, they really had understood everything, and they're describing themselves as being as good at the rabbinic tradition as he was when he was alive. He said to them, "I am he." They did not believe him, and they did not treat him with the honor that he deserved. He prayed for mercy, and his soul departed. Rava thus said, people say, "O chavruta, o mituta," give me fellowship or give me death. Right? Either I have, so what does that mean? So let's take a few pieces of this. It's a horrible story. My reading of this text would suggest that there are two different indictments taking place in this text. One indictment, obviously, is of the people. Because not just, I understand why they didn't believe that he was Choni. Why should he still be alive, right? That guy disappeared 70 years ago. Why would he materialize again, ostensibly looking the same? So I understand why they don't believe him. But then you get the second line of they didn't treat him with the respect that he deserved. That somehow, and we all know this, sometimes people connected to institutions, even the builders of those institutions, they outlive their welcome. Are you familiar with this phenomenon sometimes in Jewish life? And what happens? There creates this awkward relationship, an awkward tension between those who were supposed to plant the seeds and then move along and allow for others to reap from what was actually sown, right? They're supposed to move along, but they linger too long. They don't necessarily depart for 70 years and come back, but there's something very deeply human about this experience, and the response is to not treat them with the respect that they deserve. And that becomes a misbehavior on both ends. It is a misbehavior by those who won't extend the respect to those who came before them, who created the conditions for their possible success. But it's also a tragedy for the person who outlives his welcome. What is going on with a person who thinks that his job is to walk back into his life 70 years later and be treated as though he is still the person who is responsible for everything that's there? The hubris of Choni, as imagined in the story, why does he not walk into the study house and hear the sages say, our traditions are today as clear as they were in the days of Choni, and feel, my work is done. Wow, I am remembered, right? Because the way in which we are supposed to be immortal is through being remembered. That's what immortality is supposed to be. If I'm actually remembered, I'm immortal. He overhears that, he should leave. And recognize what I managed to do in my lifetime was to move the needle a little bit. Start the bull rolling down the hill. Plant carob trees. And then I have to expect that whoever comes in the subsequent generation are going to be the people who actually translate the actions I began into something that could be much bigger. And when I map it into this 50 years question, what does it mean to mark time? Part of me says, our job is not in moments, even when I mark time, to feel this fear that if I don't fix this problem in my lifetime, how could I live through 50 years of this and it not be what I want to be? My job is not to fix a problem in my lifetime, but to be responsible for the incremental change that should take place throughout my lifetime in the hope, in that terrifying hope, which might be belief, that if I do certain incremental steps in this lifetime, maybe those will be picked up and taken up by people beyond me. But if I have the hubris of believing that my job is to essentially be immortal, to either fix the urgent problems that a society faces, or believe that I should be able to see the reconciliation of the problems that I care about in my own lifetime, I will become like Choni, outliving my welcome and actually preventing the possibility of those who come after me to continue the work. Why did they reject him? They reject him because his presence there makes it harder for them to be them. They don't want Choni to reconcile the problems in the study house. They need to reconcile the problems in the study house. They just need to hinge the action, their own actions, on the actions of those who come before them. So I feel pulled, really deeply pulled in this moment, between the shofar blow of the Jubilee, which says to me as a Jew, who is frustrated by many aspects of the sustained occupation in Israel, of what has to happen to blow a shofar and to catalyze tremendous human Jewish social responsibility in this moment to end the occupation in our lifetime. And I also feel pulled and humbled by this Choni story of you're not supposed to operate with respect to social problems of massive magnitude on the belief that if you don't do it now, it will have failed eternally, and that you're not supposed to necessarily believe, as depressing as this is when it comes to massive social movements, that these problems, which we know are transcendent, actually get solved in your own lifetime. I'm reminded of this tremendous essay that came out a few months ago. I don't remember the author's name is. It's easily findable. It was called The Reductive Seduction of Other People's Problems. And the author argues that one of the great temptations that people have, especially Americans, especially Westerners, is to believe that problems that are very far away from them are easily solved. So there's apparently like a trail like leading all the way to the moon of patents that have been advanced from people living like in Red Hook for water systems that would provide water for people in sub-Saharan Africa. And they none of them have ever worked. And why is that? Why does that happen psychologically? And the reason it happens psychologically is that when you actually confront complicated problems, you know, when you see them up close, you know that it takes a tremendous amount of work to actually fix a problem, and that the best you're going to get at is an asymptotic relationship to change, which is you might get closer to approach the limit, but you'll never actually reach it. And that if you were trying to fix the problem of a poverty down your street in Brooklyn, the amount of work you'd have to do, run for office and galvanize this and this petition and this social change, et cetera, is really difficult. So instead, we gravitate towards problems that are very far away, because problems from very far away seem like all they require is some sort of technical fix. And I wonder about also the psychological issue that I fear about our community is that we register with a social problem that we know is intractable and it can't be fixed, and we think that the answer to that is by speaking louder about how it needs to be fixed. We know this is a problem, but what would be the incremental carob tree planting technologies that one would do upon the recognition that I'm marking a historical anniversary that would breed the prospect of social change as opposed to being the radical shofar blowing activities that I'm not sure works and that are even feared in the biblical text itself as not granting enough dignity to the fears of the individuals involved in that change process that their security needs are not fully met. One last comment, and then I'll take some questions. I'm not going to do part two. Come study with us in the summer, and we'll do it. But the reason it's there is because what I'm leaving for you to think about are if we're not necessarily capable of transforming the political realities of Israel overnight, And I really think that one of the things that we're not doing right in Jewish life in America around Israel is that we think it is our job to fix Israel's problems as opposed to our job to think about what is our relationship to Israel, both because that relationship to Israel could be useful towards if you actually could fix Israel's problems, but also because, as always, we are best capable of fixing our own problems than we are others. But what I gave to you for part two is just a little bit of a beginning of a curriculum for the question of what it might look like to transact a conversation towards incremental change when we think in terms of absolute values that we might be able to use across political difference, as opposed to the conversation where it currently transacts itself in the Jewish community, in which talking about Israel is always defined by solutions. Let me add one more sentence on that. If I talk about the two-state solution, I don't really have to talk about morals, because all of the moral conclusions that I want are embedded in the solution that is down the line. It actually, in some ways, talking about solutions hampers the prospect of slow moral work. Just fix the overall problem, and the moral character of Israel will become what we want it to become. Number one, I'm not sure that a two-state solution is imminent. That's my gentle way of breaking the news. But number two, the Choni model of incremental change requires you to not think of my job in this moment is to bring about a solution. The Choni model says my job is to cultivate moral possibility to the society that I want in the hope that I can ultimately coalesce based on the fact that more people are committed to that moral framework of the society they want to actually entrench in law and in structure the society that we actually need. And so I left here for you to just think about, could these, in essence, be the beginning of a moral conversation the more that it's disconnected from the concrete activities of a political conversation? I'll say as a footnote, I think this methodology could also be helpful to rebuilding some of the social fractures in America. if we stop talking as much about policy and the difference between Trump voters and Clinton voters, and talked about where do we actually have some sort of notion of shared values, and that we might think that our political solutions respond differently to those shared values, we might be able to rebuild a society. But what I hoped to try to lay on the table for us today to think about is that the marking of time pushes us in two instinctive emotional directions. One, to see that a massive anniversary catalyzes in us a sense of urgency to fix or to cement or to seal the deal. And at the same time, this voice from our tradition that says, your job is to advance the slow-moving moral processes of change towards that society that you want with the necessary humility that you oftentimes, possibly never, don't get to see the actual transformation of the world that you want. And my hope is that this is the start of a way in which our community, even just by holding these two pillars together, our community might be able to have a healthier, more sustaining conversation about these historical anniversaries than the one that threatens to overtake us. Thank you.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS, the Jewish Broadcasting Service, with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the JBS homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to GEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.